phone can be blessed with the fastest processor in the world. But if it's saddled with a slow screen, it'll still feel sluggish, especially compared to a similarly equipped device with faster panels. That is why the iPhone 13 Pro's most important feature is its new ProMotion display. But ProMotion is only on the Pro and Pro Max models this year, making it one of the features that differentiate them from the less premium iPhone 13 and 13 mini. For an extra $200 to $300, the Pro series also offers an additional telephoto camera, a new macro photography mode, as well as more power and endurance. So the question is, are the iPhone 13 Pro and Pro Max's new cameras and screens worth the extra money? Before we get into those features though, there is one thing you should consider: weight. At 204 grams or 7.19 ounces, the 6.1 inch 13 Pro is heavier than the 12 Pro and the iPhone 13. The 13 Pro Max, which has a 6.7 inch screen, outweighs last year's Pro Max, as well as the Galaxy S21 Ultra. I don't mind the regular 13 Pro, but Apple's chonkiest boy was uncomfortable to use in one hand for longer than a few minutes. In addition to being heavier than their predecessors, the iPhone 13 Pro and Pro Max are a teeny tiny bit thicker too. They also have bigger rear camera modules and slightly smaller display notches. Otherwise, Apple hasn't strayed very far from the 12 Pro's design. They all have similar stainless steel bodies with glass coverings and are rated IP68 for water and dust resistance. Even the colors are familiar. The typical trio of graphite, gold, and silver are accompanied by this year's Sierra Blue, which is lighter and paler than last generation's Pacific Blue. I prefer the new shade. It's a little paler and more interesting than last year's nondescript, deeper hue. I realized something when I started testing the iPhone 13 series last week. Basically, everything I do on my phone requires scrolling. Think about it. Browsing social feeds, checking a list of file names, looking for the right component on a spec sheet, checking conversation history, creeping on my Instagram viewers, reading articles, and a whole lot more. This is why Apple's new ProMotion screens on the iPhone 13 Pro and Pro Max are a big deal, and also why it's kind of annoying that it took the company this long to adopt a faster panel. Google was already a little behind when it added 90Hz panels to the Pixel 4 after companies like Samsung and OnePlus had already introduced higher refresh rates, and not just on premium top-tier Android devices either. Apple being late to adopt a feature is nothing new. What is important is that the faster screens on the iPhones makes a world of difference. Like many Android phones, the iPhone 13 Pro and Pro Max will adjust their refresh rates to what you're doing. They can go as low as 10Hz for when you're looking at a static image, or up to 120Hz for scrolling and compatible games. Aside from ProMotion, the iPhone 13 Pro's OLED displays are also 25% brighter than their predecessors, which is nice for outdoor reading. I enjoyed watching the visual perfection that is Doja Cat's Kiss Me More music video on the iPhone 13 Pro's True Tone display. The rosy, cotton candy hues looked vibrant, while the singer's individual lashes were clear. The stereo speakers also did a respectable job of delivering crisp audio with adequate bass. Other things like voices and instrumental background music and videos and games all came through clearly as well. Apple says that the iPhone 13 Pro's rear cameras got the biggest upgrade ever, attributing it to next-level hardware that captures so much more detail. The triple 12-megapixel setup includes a primary sensor with a large f1.5 aperture, a 77mm telephoto lens, and an ultra-wide option with a 120-degree field of view. There's also a new macro photography feature thanks to the updated ultra-wide lens, as well as software like Photographic Styles and Cinematic Mode. Those two are also offered on the iPhone 13 and 13 mini, and you can check my review of those phones for the details. In short though, I like that Photographic Styles lets you easily customize and set a sort of default for the contrast levels and color temperature of your images. Meanwhile, though Cinematic Mode is good at identifying faces and people in a scene and then blurring out everything surrounding a subject, it struggles when I try to change the focal point. The system is also a little wonky at outlining individuals, and stray body parts like thumbs, ears, and noses can get eaten up in the artificial blur. I found that adjusting the intensity via the f-stop setting helped to minimize this, but then that lessened the DSLR-like quality of the video. One feature the pros have over the regular 13s is macro photography. With this generation, you can get as close as 2 centimeters away from your subject and still capture it in focus. Apple doesn't offer a way for you to manually enable a macro mode. The system will automatically switch to the close-up camera when you get all up in something's face. The iPhone 13 Pro was generally accurate at knowing when I was trying to get a tight shot, but it kept changing back and forth between macro and regular views. Sometimes it would continually focus and refocus on the flowers behind the buds I was trying to shoot. Apple has said it will be releasing a software update that should prevent the camera from switching in and out of macro mode, though since I've yet to receive it, I can't tell you how effective this will be. When it did work as expected, macro mode delivered surprisingly great results. My shots of a closed flower bud and the vein system on a leaf surface were eye-catchingly detailed, showing individual hairs on the stem and petals. Close-ups of a fried fish clearly rendered the oil oozing out of the batter. You need to make sure to let enough light shine on your subject though, because my shots of a bee inside a flower were dark and splotchy. Still, that's basically photography 101, so it's not an issue specific to macro mode. In general, the iPhone 13 Pro took sharp and colorful photos, rivaling those from the Pixel 5 and Galaxy S21 Ultra. Apple's default treatment renders pictures that are typically brighter and sometimes more saturated than the other two, but with Photographic Styles, you can pick a look that you like and stick with it. I am also not a fan of the iPhone's aggressive HDR effects compared to the Pixel's more neutral landscapes. But frankly, we're at a point where Apple, Google, and Samsung are generally on par. The iPhone 13 Pro's upgraded sensors also really improved low-light performance. I took photos of the moon peeking through some clouds in the middle of Manhattan skyscrapers with the S21 Ultra, Pixel 5, and iPhone 13 Pro. And they were all impressively clean and sharp. Google still does retain an advantage with night sight though. It just produces photos that are significantly cleaner, brighter, and more detailed. As for the 13 Pro's front camera, it's pretty much the same as the iPhone 13's. And that's not a bad thing. You'll still get cinematic mode and Photographic Styles via the 12 megapixel true depth sensor. And though selfies were a little soft in low light, they were tack sharp otherwise. The iPhone 13 series runs iOS 15 out of the box, and I was already able to test most of its new features when I covered the beta. Focus modes, for example, lets you set custom homepages and notification profiles based on your location or time of day. It's one of my favorite new features on any smartphone platform in recent years because it allows people without a separate work device to switch off from work whenever they want. Since most of iOS 15's new features are coming to older iPhones though, they're unlikely to sway your decision on whether to upgrade. I'm especially looking forward to testing out SharePlay when that rolls out in a later release, and it'll let me watch shows with or stream my phone screen to my friends over FaceTime. The main difference between the iPhone 13 and 13 Pro's processors is that the latter uses a beefier 5-core GPU. This means that graphics-intensive tasks like gaming or video editing should be executed more quickly. And I was surprised by how much better the Pro was at this. I made a trailer in iMovie, and while I had to wait 51 seconds for it to finish exporting on the iPhone 13, it took the iPhone 13 Pro a mere 14 seconds to be done. The iPhone 13 Pro's A15 Bionic chip is similarly powerful in less intensive tasks. I played rounds of Catan, watched various YouTube videos, chatted with my friends, played music, and snapped photos in rapid succession, all without even the slightest delay. In the week or so that I've had the iPhone 13 Pros, I've only needed to charge them twice. Granted, I spent most of the first few days focusing on the iPhone 13 and 13 mini, using the Pros predominantly when I was doing intensive camera testing. But when I switched over to the more premium devices, the iPhone 13 Pro lasted almost a full 2 days before needing a charge. Battery levels dipped more quickly when I was playing games and exporting videos, but not so much that I had to worry about running out of juice. I still have more tests to run, but it's safe to say for now that the iPhone 13 Pro and Pro Max will stick around longer than a day. With faster screens, superb performance, and long-lasting batteries, the iPhone 13 Pro and Pro Max are excellent phones. If you're on a device older than the 12 Pros, you should consider upgrading just for the new promotion displays. Though the cameras also got a noteworthy improvement, I'm not sure they're going to be the biggest draw. It's honestly hard to notice the difference in quality between photos taken by Apple's most recent flagships too. Features like cinematic mode, photographic styles, and macro cameras are nice to have, but they're not going to define your iPhone 13 Pro experience. And though Apple was playing catch up to Android flagships by finally introducing 120Hz screens to its phones, there are now fewer things that Samsung and Google offer that the iPhones don't. Basically, for anyone who doesn't mind iOS, the iPhone 13 Pro and Pro Max, if you don't mind the wait, is a worthy upgrade. For in-depth reviews on all of the phones in Android and iPhone land, as well as coverage of all the things in consumer technology, make sure you subscribe to Engadget. And as always, thank you for watching.